Hello, and welcome to another episode about aquatic ecological succession. In the previous video, I showed how an empty body of water went through ecological succession for 2.5 months. If you want to see the exciting first stages, I strongly suggest watching that video. Here's a very brief recap of what happened. After 2 weeks, a leaf fell in, bringing with it a lot of organic matter into the system. After almost 2 months, an explosion of life resulted in the brownish color of the water. And as can be seen on the bottom, a lot of organic matter was starting to accumulate, which all fell in, like this leaf. It was the first major ecological change in this young ecosystem. After 2.5 months, the water turned completely green, another major change. It was at this point completely filled with unicellular algae and other microbes, and was becoming a very densely populated ecosystem, starting from nothing but clean water. Multicellular structures even started to appear. This is a microscopic view of the life present in this community. These are large strings of cyanobacteria, many unicellular algae. We can see some bacteria zooming around, and there's even protozoans present, like this Vorticella over here. All this after just 2.5 months. And now for a really quick recap on what aquatic ecological succession is. Unicellular organisms, and then larger microbes, appear in an empty body of water. After they die, they accumulate as organic matter on the bottom. This substrate layer can be used by algae and plants to grow, providing food and shelter for larger animals like Delphinia and insect larvae. They all die and add to the growing substrate layer. The water gets shallower and emerging plants start to grow. The ecosystem keeps growing in complexity and fish and amphibians start to appear. Everything just keeps dying, resulting in even shallower water with space for floating, swamp and marsh plants. Eventually, fully terrestrial plants start growing. In the end, through ecological succession, the empty body of water turns into a terrestrial forest ecosystem. Don't worry, we've still got a long way to go, so strap in and see what happens in the coming months. 2 weeks after the last update, the water was much clearer, and a lot of algae was growing on the sides of the tub, producing a lot of oxygen. A few days later, I saw that an ant colony started exploring the tub. And I saw another insect hovering above the water. A day later, there were many more. They are a family of mosquitoes known all too well to Dutch people during summer, Ceratopogonidae. But we call them knutjes, as well as knaasjes, knozels and mietsen. They are known as nosiums to English speakers. The reason they are hovering above the water like this is because they are looking for a place to lay their eggs. Unlike a lot of other mosquitoes, they don't lay their eggs directly in the water, as their larvae are not purely aquatic. It does not appear that they have found a satisfactory location yet. 2 days later, a lot of structure suddenly appeared on the surface. That's because a lot of the algae that was growing on the sides of the tub started to let go and float up. As expected, this increase in structure immediately resulted in eggs. In fact, this knutje is laying eggs as we speak, and so is this one. Two and a half weeks later, almost all of the algae mats on the sides of the tub either sank down to the bottom or floated up to the surface. Other than that, not much has changed. The same can't be said for the ecosystem at 4 months old. Prepare to get jiggly. Because at 4.5 months old, the entire tub is filled with tiny black dots. Every black dot is a nosium pupa. Let's take a closer look. Here we have a pupa next to a dead adult. And these are pupae, as well as a single larva, wiggling next to the empty skin of knutjes that have already emerged. It's quite insane just how many of these pupae are in here. You quickly saw them spread around the water surface earlier, but they are also found on all the sides and bottom of the tub, as well as in the water column. It's freaky just how many are in here. Of course, every pupae was once a larva. We already saw one, but almost all of the larvae are found on the bottom of the tub. It's hard to see how many are in here because the water is quite unclear, but it's a lot. There's also a few larvae of another species, but I'm not sure what they are exactly. Here we see a larva up close. Apart from swimming in the water column, it can also move on surfaces, like the edge of the tub. It does so by alternating its mouth and tail parts to grab hold of the surface, in a similar way to leeches and their two suction cups. And that is the state of this ecosystem after 4.5 months. The ecological succession has led to higher life forms, in this case insects, to be introduced into the ecosystem. This is, at least to me, a very exciting result and change in the ecosystem dynamics. So far, it has all gone quite like expected. Everyone knows that mosquitoes will colonize just about every body of water during summer. That is also the reason I advise against doing this project yourself, if you live in an area of the world where mosquitoes are vectors for dangerous diseases. And now, let's take a closer look at some of those larvae and pupae. Here we have a pupa, and what I found interesting about this shot is that you can see a lot of microbes using this pupa's body as a structure to hold on to. This is, by the way, the only proper use for a shot glass. Here you can see again that these pupae are living in a sort of microbe soup. That is simply not apparent when looking with the naked eye. Here is a larva up close, or actually a ball of pupae and larvae. The reason they're clinging together like this is because they are looking for structure, but the only structures they can find are each other's bodies. That is also why seahorses cling to each other if kept together with little structure, or why tubifex are in a ball if you buy them as live food. Here you can get a bit of a closer look at the heads and mouth parts of the larvae. Do you know what these neck pillow looking things are? They're magnified 160 times. No? You don't? Come on, make an effort! Here, I'll show them magnified 400 times. It can't be that hard, right? And no, they're not actually tiny neck pillows. One last guess? Yeah, that's right, they are embryos of the Ceratopogonidae. I knew you'd get it. So, this is what developing mosquito eggs look like up close. So far, we've only really discussed the succession on the scale that we could see with the naked eye. But of course, succession also takes place on another scale, especially for really young ecosystems like this one. The microscopic scale. Let's start with some creatures of which I actually know the name. You might have already caught a glimpse of these animals in the close-up shots of the knutjes larvae. This is a rotifer. Here are a bunch of them at 160 times magnification. They are really abundant in the water. This is a nice shot where you can see one feeding. These little aquatic animals feed by creating vortices with their mouthparts. If you look closely, you can see that they appear to have two bulbs with cilia on them. This is called the corona. It does not actually consist of two bulbs, but it is a complex structure that is difficult to see. By beading the cilia on the corona, it creates a vortex. This sucks in water, and along with it food particles, which then enter the mouth and are subsequently digested. The shape of this corona varies a lot between species. There seems to be only one species of rotifer very abundant in this ecosystem, but I don't know which exact species it is, although I am fairly certain that it is in the class of bdelloidae and the family of Phyllodinidae, which has a corona that actually does consist of two discs. These animals eat just about anything they can find, as long as it's small. Stuff like bacteria, algae, detritus, and whatever else fits. Do you see the structure inside its neck that looks like a beating heart? Well, it isn't a heart at all. It is something called the mastax organ. It is essentially a sort of mouth, where powerful muscles push together tiny hard calcified structures called the trophy, which is what you're seeing as a beating heart, and thereby crushing up food entering the mastax. The shape of these trophy can vary based on the diet of the species. Carnivorous species, as well as parasitic ones, have trophy in a shape that helps grip or bite, while suspension feeders have more grinding ridges. That's interesting enough, but I think we need to talk about rotifer sex, or rather, the lack of it, because, at least for bdelloidae rotifers, a male has never been observed. Instead, only females exist, reproducing through parthenogenesis, where new rotifers are born out of unfertilized eggs. It has been thought that bdelloid rotifers have been asexual for millions of years, but still managed to diversify into over 450 species. It has been theorized that bdelloidae evolved to be asexual due to certain parthenogenic strains that lost the ability to respond to sex-inducing signals. These lineages, therefore, remained asexual. They can still produce the signal, but cannot respond to it anymore, and therefore, quite tragically, sex is never induced anymore. Here, at 400 times magnification, we have some ciliates, that at first glance might look like paramecia, but are actually, to the best of my knowledge, James Wise, if you're watching, please correct me if I'm wrong, spirotrich. Like other ciliates, they have cilia, tiny hair-like structures used for motion. What makes spirotrich special is that they also have organelles called cirri, which are the longer-looking hairs you can see on their front and back end. They are a bundle of many cilia together. Like cilia, they are used for swimming and food capture, but unlike cilia, they can function as tiny feet, allowing the spirotrichs to crawl over surfaces. Here, magnified 160 times, we see the last microbe I want to focus on. There's a few of them in this shot. They look like clear balls with a tiny colorful ball inside of it and two tentacles sticking out with which they move. This is a sample collected deep in the water column, remember that. Those tentacles are actually flagellae and the microbe is an algae called haematococcus. Here we have some intensely red balls. But wait, Didn't I say the haematococcus was the last microbe I wanted to focus on? I did, yes. So, was I lying? No. Because these red balls are also haematococcus. It's just that these are in cyst form. Remember in the previous shot that I collected a haematococcus in the deeper part of the water? Well, these cysts were collected on the surface of the water, which is precisely the reason they are cysts, in order to protect themselves from ultraviolet radiation. As you might have noticed, they have a beautiful red color. This color is actually used as food coloring, and these little algae are even the reason flamingos are pink, because small crustaceans feed on them, turning red, and flamingos eat the crustacean, turning pink themselves. Pretty cool, huh? These were just the microbes I had time for to focus on, but as you could see, there's a lot more microbes zooming around. If you recall the microbial community of this ecosystem at 2.5 months old, you'll notice that it has become a lot more diverse. Even just looking at the scale of microbes, I think it is absolutely fascinating and just really, really cool to see a large and diverse community of microbes consisting of completely different types, forming seemingly out of nowhere from an empty tub of water in just a matter of months. It is ecological succession on a small scale happening right in front of our eyes, and I think that's just amazing. So, this has been the 4.5 month process of filling a tub with quote-unquote pure water and seeing what happens due to aquatic ecological succession. Where it started slowly with some leaves falling in, we now have a diverse ecosystem on different scales in which even higher forms of life, like insects, are beginning their life. I hope you liked it, because that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.